Good evening. Good evening. My name is Sivan Terzian. I'm a faculty member in the School of Teaching and Learning, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to our keynote address as the culmination of today's inaugural College of Education Research Symposium. What a wonderful event it's been. And I want to thank all of you for participating, and especially those who envision and organize this event. And that includes SAGE President Elizabeth Curran, ECC President Stephanie Schroeder, Associate Dean Nancy Waldron, and many others. I'd also like to acknowledge the support that we've received from a number of groups here on campus, including the Student Alliance of Graduates in Education, the Education College Council, University of Florida Center for the Study of Race and Race Relations, the Bob Graham Center for Public Service, and the University of Florida Student Government. It's my pleasure tonight to introduce our guest speaker, Professor Benjamin Justice, who is Associate Professor in the Department of Educational Theory, Policy, and Administration, and by courtesy, the Department of History at Rutgers University, where he has taught since 2002. Professor Justice also co-coordinates the Social Studies Education Program at Rutgers. He is truly impressive in the breadth of his scholarly research. It spans issues of interest to historians of education, political philosophers, legal scholars, social studies educators, and others. His first book, The War That Wasn't, Religious Conflict and the Compromise in the Common Schools of New York State, 1865 to 1900, was published in 2005. Professor Justice's second book is an edited volume called The Founding Fathers, Education and the Great Contest, the American Philosophical Society Essay Prize of 1797. And this book received a special award from the American Educational Studies Association Critics' Choice Book Award. Professor Justice has a co-authored book coming with Colin McLeod called Have a Little Faith, Religion, Democracy, and the American Public School, which will be published with the University of Chicago Press. He's even written a fascinating article that I've read about Disney's representation of female characters in animated films. Clearly, he has a gift for engaging multiple scholarly audiences. Professor Justice has also gained distinction for his teaching. He received the Outstanding Faculty Teaching Award from the Rutgers Graduate School of Education. This is not surprising to me. Ben has developed a reputation as being an outstanding mentor of graduate students, most recently at our History of Education Society conference, where he led a multi-day mentoring session in the historical archives in St. Louis. The reports from our students were that this was an exceptionally engaging, fulfilling, and exhausting event. The United States today has one of the world's highest incarceration rates, roughly 700 prisoners for every 100,000 residents. And this does not include the tens of thousands of youth in juvenile detention. As the keynote speaker for today's inaugural research symposium, Professor Justice will address the hidden curriculum of justice, how the American criminal justice system educates and miseducates citizens. His talk derives in part from his incisively analyzed article co-authored with Professor Tracy Mears that appeared in the Annals of the American Academy of Political and Social Science. By casting the criminal justice system as an educational institution that impacts all Americans, we are compelled to consider the many implicit and pervasive civic lessons residing in an array of societal institutions. I can't think of a more urgent educational issue in our society or a better person to help us understand it than our esteemed guest today. Please join me in welcoming Professor Ben Justice.
Thank you.
Is okay? Okay. So thank you all very much for coming. Thank you, Dr. Kerzian, for that terrific introduction. And I want to thank all of the graduate students today who were at the Research Symposium who had both the skill and the courage to show strangers and their colleagues their work at all various stages. It was really very inspiring. So congratulations to all of you, and I'm honored to be here to share some of my research with you now. Now, the research that I'm about to share with you is based on work that I've done with Tracy Mears at Yale Law School, and also grows from my ongoing work with the Deconstructing Ferguson Working Group and the Justice Collaboratory at Yale Law School. This talk brings together separate and quite distinct bodies of knowledge, education, and criminal justice. Along the way, it integrates scholarship from history, law, political science, and sociology. While this work is part of a growing movement among scholars to look at the civic effects of mass incarceration, my central contention that the criminal justice system may be understood using curriculum theory is novel and, I hope, useful. Now, there are two primary points of contact between most citizens and the government, right? Public schools and the criminal justice system. And typically, when we think of these two institutions, we think of the schools as being in charge of providing the education of citizens and the criminal justice system being in charge of policing and adjudicating and eventually punishing breaches of the law. What I will argue today is that the criminal justice system has become so pervasive in our society that we have to pay attention to it as an actual educative institution. And as an educative institution, it has a curriculum. And that curriculum is both formal and informal. On the one hand, the formal curriculum claims to support and reinforce notions of democracy, of fairness, of forgiveness. The hidden curriculum, which I'll explain in a minute, sends quite an opposite set of messages about who matters and who doesn't matter, who is more or less a citizen, and who is more or less deserving of mercy and justice. Now, to do this, I'm going to look at three aspects of the system. The first is the jury, the second is policing, and the third is punishment, or in our society, that's primarily incarceration. But before I do that, I actually need to take a quick detour to 18th century France. So, no doubt, all of you have read Montesquieu's famous treatise, The Spirit of the Laws, from 1748. In it, when you were reading it, I'm sure that you noticed that actually Montesquieu makes a really important point as people are imagining the formation of states. And it almost seems commonsensical, but he got a whole wonderful book out of it. And it's this, that the spirit of the laws of any given society should support the type of government that the society has. So in a republic, of course, every citizen is sovereign. That means that the laws need to make sure that they support that idea of the sovereignty of the citizen. In particular, Montesquieu urges two things that we should consider. The first is that you need to have universal public education so that each citizen learns to identify with the government and to love the government. Now, when he's talking about love and loving the government, he's no fool, right? We don't all love the government. But what he does, what he's talking about is something that today's social psychologists would refer to as legitimacy. And the idea of legitimacy is something here, it's defined here by the NRC, but there are other definitions that are quite similar. It means that people must feel obligated to voluntarily defer to its rule or authority. A legitimate authority is one that is regarded by people as entitled to have its rules and decisions accepted and followed by others. For Montesquieu, that's love. What that means is I trust that my interest will be represented. Even if I don't always get what I want, I know that the system will treat me fairly, it will treat me with respect, it will show me that I'm equally regarded to other citizens, and that makes it legitimate. Now, he also has a very important insight into what we would call criminal justice today.
And that is that in a republic, you have to be very careful about the kinds of punishments that you have. If punishment is too harsh, it's actually dangerous to a republic because, he writes, the minds of the people are corrupted and become habituated to despotism. In other words, we lose our ability to regard our fellow citizen in ways that are going to enhance the legitimacy of our collective republic. Now, it turns out that Montesquieu was a very, very important figure for the people who created our system of government, the authors of the United States Constitution and state constitutions. Montesquieu was also an important figure in the early 19th century as Americans were developing their system of laws. Okay. So, back to this problem of we don't think of criminal justice as educative, Montesquieu is challenging us to do that. And you could say that in what Montesquieu would call moderate times, when justice is actually meted fairly reasonably, when punishment is rare and not too harsh, that we could maybe forgive that oversight. But the problem is that today we don't live in such a system. We live in a system that he would not call moderate, it would be immoderate. In the past four decades, there has been a revolution in the American criminal justice system. It has been described variously as a collapse, a plague, or the rise of a new Jim Crow. Now, whether we look at the involvement of ordinary citizens in rendering justice through jury trials, the explosive relations between police and people of color, or the rise of mass incarceration, the relationship between Americans and the criminal justice system has become so pervasively at odds with our republican form of government that we cannot ignore its profound and disproportionately negative effects as a source of American civic education. So to understand Montesquieu in modern terms, it's useful to look at curriculum theory. Anybody know what the word curriculum means? Literally, in Latin? Latin scholars here? So a curriculum is literally a race course. Right? We think of it in terms of what kids study in school, but the word originally meant a race course. Here's the great Jesse Owens, perfect person to have in a race course. The theory goes something like this. So the over-curriculum of the race course is a series of experiences that students will have when they go through school so that by the end of running this track, they will have transformed into something else. They'll get better, they'll get smarter. Ideally, in a public educational system, they'll become better citizens. They'll be more law-abiding, they'll feel that love that Montesquieu wants them to feel, and we as a society can keep on functioning. Right? Because it's systematic, because it's well-designed, we can actually try to craft the type of citizen or the type of student who goes through the system. The artifacts of this system kind of look like legal contracts. They are found in state standards, they're found in the lesson plans of teachers, they're found in legal code that regulates what schools can or can't do, they are found in the table of contents of a textbook. The formal curriculum is the kind of stuff that if you're an educational researcher, it's really easy to find. You can go on the web, you can look through official reports of institutions, and there's the formal curriculum. And importantly, the formal curriculum is publicly debated, and this is very important. When you live in a democracy, you need to have some role for everybody to have a say in what goes on in the public schools. Okay, well, curriculum theorists say, that's nice and that's good and that's important. But as you're running that racetrack, there's another curriculum that is also happening. And that's what is called the hidden curriculum. The hidden curriculum, unlike the over curriculum, is not based on an architecture of structured experiences that are moving toward a particular end, but it is instead what you learn and what you are exposed to by going through the daily grind of life in an institution. It has to do with what the institution needs you to do. So, for example, think about what kids learn in kindergarten or first grade. Now, you can tell me what they learn in terms of, you know, the literacy skills they're supposed to get, or maybe it's, you know, basic numeracy, or they're thinking about different shapes or what have you. But you know what they are experiencing? They're experiencing that they learned how to stand in line. They learned who it was okay to sit with or not sit with. They learned how they stacked up in the social hierarchy of their classroom. They learned who the teacher likes better or doesn't like better. And over time, not in one day, but in a series of moments where they run this race course, they actually are exposed to an entire curriculum that sends them a whole other set of messages about what their relationship is to authority in the classroom, right? And you could argue more broadly, since they're participating in a public education, who they are in that public. Now, not surprisingly, the hidden curriculum is very susceptible to implicit bias, right? That shouldn't surprise anybody, because in the daily grind, when a teacher, board administrator, or even students are going through and trying to live institutional life, they are, of course, enacting things unthinkingly. So while the overt curriculum claims to be impartial, and should claim to be impartial in a democracy, the hidden curriculum is not. And finally, the hidden curriculum is not open to outsiders. You kind of have to be in there, right? Ethnographers, I know a number of you are doing ethnographic studies in schools. Ethnographers go in, and actually part of what you're doing is you're trying to see, like, what is the hidden curriculum? What's really going on here? What messages are kids getting, right? This is not publicly debated, but it's what goes on. Okay, so the question then becomes, how can we take the lessons from curriculum theory and how can we apply them to thinking about the criminal justice system and the messages that it sends to citizens? And I told you we would look briefly at three aspects of the criminal justice system: the jury, policing, and incarceration. So we'll turn to the first one, which is the jury. Here is a Norman Rockwell image of the jury. You know, if Norman Rockwell is painting something, chances are it has some iconic function in American society. Let me just ask you something. How many of you have actually served on a jury? Okay, not very many, right? Right, that's pretty interesting. Okay, and it's interesting for the following reason. The jury is supposed to be a really happy story, right? That's what we learn. I mean, the jury is that place where Americans inherited from English common law this check on the aristocracy, where the people actually could buffer the rather unlimited power of the people in charge, right? Now, something interesting happens in the early 19th century in American juries, which is that in a government of the people, it doesn't make a lot of sense to have a buffer because the criminal justice system is supposed to be fair. So Americans start talking about the jury as a place where actually people can get an education. The jury has an overt curriculum, and that overt curriculum, first, as I said, used to be a check on elites. Some people still feel that it is. Right? Tocqueville, when he visited in the early 19th century, described the jury as a free school. It was a place where citizens learned to mingle with other citizens. It's where the high and the low could be there making decisions together. It's where people learned the law. And it was also a place, and we talk about juries this way today too, it's a place where communities can actually experience the consequences of justice. They see what happens when the laws are applied to real people who, at least in theory, they are representing by being on this jury and being a part of this jury experience. Okay, now, we can imagine an ideal hidden curriculum for the jury. The first point would be that most criminal offenses would have a jury trial, right? Because that's what juries are for. The second would be that, of course, jury service would be universal and would be impartial. so that it would be equal across class, across gender, across race, and across other social characteristics. Right? That seems pretty straightforward. Okay, the reality is a little bit different, and you actually got a sampling of it right now, right? Most people in here actually haven't served on a jury. Now, granted, we are at a college, right, and a university, so many of you have been exempt from jury service. Nevertheless, juries are incredibly rare in the United States. Most people don't know this. 90% of felony convictions in the United States are plea bargained. They do not go to a jury. And of the remaining 10%, about a third of those are bench trials. Second, studies of juries have shown that there is certainly implicit and sometimes explicit bias in jury selection. So even if you make it into the pool, it turns out that there is a hidden curriculum of who is more or less valued as a person on a jury. Now, this is complicated. In fact, there was a Supreme Court decision about this, regulating what are known as peremptory challenges, which is to say that the prosecution, because the prosecution has to have the burden of trying to make a case to a jury, can actually excuse jurors for various reasons. But what they can't do is excuse them based on race. So there's a very important 2010 study by the Equal Justice Initiative, and I just want to read you what ended up happening in the study of 10 states in capital cases where they looked at the reasons that prosecutors gave to exclude jurors. Now remember, they can't use race, right? So here's what they used. The reasons included: because the juror appeared to have low intelligence. Oh, by the way, these are ones that they used on African-American jurors. Because they appeared to have low intelligence, wore eyeglasses, were single, were married, were separated, were too old for jury service at age 43, or were too young at age 28. African-Americans in capital cases have been barred for having relatives who attended historically black colleges, for the way that they walk, for chewing gum, and frequently for living in predominantly black neighborhoods, which is a racially neutral determination problem. These race-neutral explanations and the tolerance of racial bias by court officials have, I'm reading now from the report, have made jury selection for people of color a hazardous venture where the sting of exclusion often is accompanied by painful insults and injurious commentary. Okay, and now juror exclusion aside, we have another problem, and this we'll talk about in a little bit with mass incarceration, and that is 1 in 8 African-American men in the United States is not eligible to vote or serve on the jury because of laws that relate to your eligibility to vote if you've been incarcerated or are currently incarcerated. So if we compare the overt and the hidden curriculum of the jury system, we see that at best, the jury has become an empty symbol of civic participation in the meeting of justice. And at worst, a highly suspect and racist set of experiences for people on the aggregate now, not every individual for sure, right? We're talking about aggregates. On the aggregate, that sends negative messages about who matters more or who matters less in the process of deciding about the meaning of justice. Okay. Now you could say, well, that's nice, but you know, juries are small potatoes, and you know, most trials don't go to jury, or most convictions don't go to jury. Okay. That might be true, but then let's go to police. Police are referred to as many things, right? But rarely are they referred to as teachers. But if you think about it, police are oftentimes the primary contact point for citizens with the criminal justice system. Now, the overt curriculum of policing is pretty straightforward, right? There are constitutional checks on police power. Police have to respect the sovereignty of the individual. For example, the Fourth Amendment specifies that stops, arrests, and searches are justified only when police have good reasons, i.e. facts on which to rely when, interpreted against the background of an officer's experience causes that officer to conclude that the person about to be seized probably has or is about to commit a crime. Okay, well, you know, fair enough. This legal regime, fundamental to our national identity, is designed to convey concern for rights in ways that legitimize the state and respect the sovereignty of the citizen. The overt curriculum of policing is not grounded entirely in law, however. Police actions are also motivated by multiple reasons, including the reduction of crime. Now, interestingly, people didn't always used to think that the police could actually reduce crime. They thought all they could do was do a better job of catching the criminals. They thought that crime was a product of more of environment, and police actually couldn't control that. There's been a revolution in that thinking. You may not be aware of that. The phrase broken windows policing, for example, or zero tolerance policing. Okay. In addition, police are charged with keeping people safe. That's also very important, right? So that's the overt curriculum. Now, we can imagine an ideal hidden curriculum of policing. In that ideal hidden curriculum, every person is treated with equal dignity and respect. The best interest of individuals and communities is weighed when police have interactions with individuals, right? So, for the most part, my suspicion is that those of you who have had interactions with police have been let off with a warning, right? That's police discretion, and police discretion is a very important part of policing, and a critical one. In the ideal hidden curriculum, police discretion would operate equally among all people. Also, it would focus on de-escalation rather than escalation. Force, which is necessary in policing, absolutely, would be rare and would also be regrettable. Okay, the actual hidden curriculum of policing. And this is where my co-author, Tracy Mears, has done much of her work. I'm just gonna give you two examples. There are many examples. The first is New York City. So, in 2013 alone, 680,000 people in New York City were stopped and frisked. Okay. Approximately 10% of these encounters resulted in an arrest or summons, which raises an interesting question about the original premise that an officer has to have reasonable suspicion that the person has committed or is about to commit a crime. If only 10% of people who have been stopped and frisked have been arrested or issued a summons, there's a problem. More incredibly, in only 2% of these encounters has a weapon been. In the highest crime areas of the city, 80% of young African-American men between the ages of 18 and 24 were stopped at least once by the police in a single year. It is difficult to reconcile the overt curriculum of discretion and restraint with these numbers. We would have to accept that police reasonably believe that 80% of African-American youth residing in these areas had committed or were about to commit a crime. The social cost is even higher than the injustice experienced by these individual young men, indeed by anyone who felt that they were unjustly targeted. Moreover, any person observing a person stopped on the street might say to himself or herself, I wonder why they did that, right? There's a spectacle of arrest that you probably notice when you're driving down the highway and you see someone pulled over and you turn your neck to see what that person looks like. Poor urban-dwelling people of color bear the brunt not only of privacy and autonomy intrusions, but also of a constant stream of official messaging that they could easily interpret as signaling their lack of civic belonging. Now, in Ferguson, you had something different, not stop and frisk, but stop and fine. Some of you have probably read the Department of Justice investigation into the 2014 killing of Michael Brown. And what that found was an entire municipal police force and court apparatus that was designed to extract fines from citizens to help support the budget of the municipality. In order to generate fines, police routinely engaged in petty or unlawful stops, and these too frequently escalated into excessive use of force and unlawful arrest. This is all from the DOJ report. Unpaid fines generated still more fines and arrest warrants. The entire system of stops, fines, use of force, and arrest showed racially discriminatory intent and racially disproportionate effects. African American citizens lived in fear of arbitrary stops, arrests, violence, and a spiraling cycle of compound consequences for what were initially very small traffic violations, and in some cases, dubious traffic violations. Moreover, this was not limited to Ferguson, but was common practice throughout St. Louis County. This is evidence of a failed state, and this is Montesquieu's nightmare. Which brings us to mass incarceration. I'm actually going to start this one by just showing you some numbers. Some of you are familiar with this story, some of you are not so familiar with this story. So here we have a chart. This is still police. So the result of this, you can see, is the disproportion in confidence in the police, the white population, the national average, and the black population. Quite clearly, people of color, particularly African Americans, have a very different level of trust in police than the national average or white Americans. I would argue that this is a direct result of a different kind of curriculum in terms of how they are valued as citizens in the United States. Now, it's also important to say that, again, we're talking about aggregates. There's still a fair amount of confidence in the police here, and I don't mean to suggest that this is an all or nothing story. That's actually not how the Hinton curriculum works. It's not all or nothing. But in the ideal, we would like to see these two graphs up there look the same, right? Okay, that does bring us to punishment. So the overt curriculum of punishment obviously would be the leniency of the state. We lock people up in this country with the idea, at least for the first 150 years of locking people up, that it would be an opportunity for them to change their behavior so when they get out, they can reintegrate successfully into society, and again, in Montesquieu's conception, they would then contribute to the Republic. There's also a notion of paying your debt, that once your time in prison is over, obviously we assign different amounts of time in prison, right? The idea is it's not all or nothing. You do your time and you get out, and that is supposed to be a fair system of justice. The check on the system of justice is that the level of punishment should fit the degree of the crime. Okay, now we can also imagine the ideal hidden curriculum of punishment. Right? According to Montesquieu, I think Montesquieu is correct, and in fact, for much of United States history, imprisonment would be relatively rare. We would expect to see levels of imprisonment in the United States and Canada and the UK, for example, or maybe Germany, other economically similar countries, to be approximately the same. That number historically was usually around 100 people per 100,000. Sivan talked about some of these numbers. It varied from there maybe to about 120. That seems to at least historically be a relatively moderate level. The second would be, of course, that when you got out, you would be able to function in the Republican society, right? So you would learn democratic habits and skills. At the very least, even if you feel that it's not the job of prison to give people skills, they should have to go out and go to school for that. I can't think of anyone who would imagine that it's good for a country to have a system where people go in and come out worse than they were when they went in. That doesn't make any sense. That's a real waste of money. Okay, and finally, we would expect that the social cost would be neutral. In other words, it wouldn't make any sense in the system of punishment to have some communities, to have some localities, to have some social groups bear the cost more than others. That wouldn't make sense. All society should have to bear the cost equally of a punishment system. Okay, and of course, we would want there to be mercy and measure, because again, our republic depends on love, right? It depends on this idea of legitimacy. And if justice is too harsh, if justice shows no mercy, then of course, that cuts into our notion of legitimacy. Okay, the actual hidden curriculum of justice, Dr. Terzian has already started telling us about that. Here are some more charts. This is from the Prison Policy Initiative. This is a historical chart that looks at incarceration levels in federal prisons, local jails, and state prisons. I don't know how well you can see that from where you are. And it starts in 1925 and it goes until 2010. And what you see is from the late 1970s on, the incarceration rate in the United States just takes off. It takes off in ways that are historically unprecedented, not just in the United States, but anywhere. Let me give you some examples. So, for the sake of comparison, I will use numbers from, I think these are 2010 numbers. They might be 2012 numbers. The numbers are very close. So, in the same year that the United States incarcerated about 714 people per 100,000 residents, Canada's number was 114. Cuba was 512, Russia was 484. Certainly we can aspire to do better than Cuba and Russia. Now, if you add to the 2.2 million Americans currently behind bars, another 5 million who are not physically imprisoned, but who live directly monitored lives on probation or parole, the scope of the American carceral state is truly staggering. Now, that in itself is a hidden curriculum of justice. But it turns out that there's also, and we know this of course, there's a racial dimension to mass incarceration as well. Black males in every age cohort are 6 to 8 times more likely than their white counterparts to go to prison, with concentrations in many poor urban centers rivaling participation in public schools. Thinking comparatively, in the year 2010, the incarceration rate in jail, prison, and halfway houses for white people in America was about 450 per 100,000, which is on par with Russia. It's a very high rate. For African Americans, that number was 2,306. The poorest and least educated are the most at risk. Young African American men who do not graduate from high school today are now statistically likely to go to jail or prison. Here's a chart that shows you some numbers from 2010. Again, these include people who are not just incarcerated in jails and prisons, but also in halfway houses. So, obviously there are costs to this, right? And I'll just go through these very quickly because I suspect I'm okay on time. All right, good. And again, we're thinking about the curriculum. We're thinking about what this tells people about their relationship to the state, what messages this sends. Okay. A recent report by the NRC, this is 2013, found the following features of life behind bars. The first is overcrowding, which can lead to dysfunctional social adaptations, stress, suicidal tendencies, and substance abuse, and overburden the already meager provision for formal educational, vocational, and health services. Second, prisonization, which is to say the habituation to the institutional culture of prison, including authoritarian rule, powerlessness, and humiliation. Third, arbitrary exposure to emotional and physical trauma, including many inmates with mental illness. And that's a whole other problem unto itself, is the incarceration of the mentally ill. And finally, cut off from family and community, exacerbated by expensive and predatory telecommunications rules, making reentry difficult. Okay. Punishment is also not confined to prison. There are lifelong economic effects for felony conviction that effectively deny the offender the opportunity to participate in many sectors of the economy, as well as potential effects from the prison experience itself. In terms of political participation, as I've already mentioned, many states bar offenders from voting even after release from prison. And finally, despite a recent emphasis on reentry, there are still barriers to ex-offenders reintegrating into society and participating in social services. Now, punishment isn't just confined to the individual. The hidden curriculum of justice includes daily lessons for the families and communities of offenders of all races, with a heavy burden placed on the poor, and an especially heavy burden placed upon poor African American families and communities, where these effects are so highly concentrated. While the effects of parental or familial incarceration for children and their families are complex, for example, in some instances, you're actually better off if you have an abusive parent, not having that abusive parent around. Nevertheless, there are negative effects on family finance, school performance, and emotional health. 1 in 9 Black children in America has an incarcerated parent. My argument is not that African Americans are the only people who experience the negative consequence of mass incarceration. That's not true. Latinos, Native Americans, whites, and other groups also experience them. But the concentration of these effects is most acute for Black people. As Montesquieu would say, we have become accustomed to despotism. So that's the point I want to conclude with. The negative effects of the hidden curriculum of justice and juries, police interactions, and incarceration, and in fact, many other facets of government, I don't know if you're familiar with Joe Sauce's work on welfare workers, for example, are fairly well documented by researchers, and I will not recount them here. People of color who experience the criminal justice system firsthand or secondhand are more likely to develop negative feelings about it and about their relationship to the state. And they suffer numerous negative civic consequences as a result of these experiences. What is less well known, but needs to be, are the effects of this dual curriculum upon those Americans who do not experience it firsthand. Kids in public schools across this country do not learn about the collapse of the criminal justice system. They do not learn about the profoundly negative effects the system has on so many of our fellow citizens, or the ways in which the system offers an entirely different set of lessons on civic identity than the ones that they themselves internalize. In essence, Americans believe in two radically different realities with regard to the criminal justice system. For many people of color, and for millions of others who experience the hidden curriculum of justice, the message is that Black lives do not matter. Unfortunately, this message is conveyed as clearly and consistently to the poor and to people of color as if it had been written as a curriculum standard for a public school. Thus, the Black Lives Matter movement was born as a direct response to the outrageous police behavior that we have seen in some places. And it offers, at its core, a counter-narrative to the message that the criminal justice system sends over and over again. In other words, the Black Lives Matter movement is a rebuttal to the hidden curriculum of justice. But by the same token, we should also appreciate the ways in which, for many Americans, it is difficult to understand the argument that the Black Lives Matter movement is making, because they actually are good students. They have internalized the overt curriculum of American criminal justice, right? How you think about the system depends on which curriculum you have experienced. And so, when we think about criminal justice reform, we have to also consider, I would say, two things. The first is we have to think about what the people think about the criminal justice system and do a better job of communicating what the difference is between these two curriculums and try to bring them together. The second is that as educational scholars and researchers, We need to remember that the system sends messages to people about how important they are across the entire system. So if we make piecemeal changes to one part of the system or another part of the system and don't consider the overall messaging, then we are unlikely to succeed. And that's it. Thank you all very much for your time.
So much. We have a few minutes for questions for Professor Justice, and we have a microphone that I'm happy to distribute so that everybody can hear your question. So tell me and I'll come to you.
So what you're suggesting is that mass incarceration reflects actual increases in crime commission?
Not necessarily, but I'm just wondering if like we're becoming more violent like as a nation, and that's why incarceration
right.
is going up?
That's a really good question. I wish I had some more charts here, but I didn't want to overwhelm you. So it turns out that crime rates have risen and fallen over time, even as we saw, I'm gonna go back a couple slides. So remember that historical slide of just the increase, right, that just keeps on trucking, right? In the middle of that increase, there's actually a dip and a long, steady decline in violent crime. So you would expect in a rational system that incarceration would also decline, right? But it hasn't. It's continued to expand. The reason this started is that there was a crime wave in the late 1960s and 1970s that many people who are my age or older actually remembered. It was terrible, and there was a lot of, and this crime wave happened not just in the United States, but across many developed countries. What's interesting, though, is that the United States actually adopted a different approach, which was incredibly harsh and punitive. Other countries with similar crime waves did not. And that's why their prison numbers are so different than ours. I don't know if that directly answered your question. I mean, I can tell you crime commission certainly varies. People who live in areas of incredibly concentrated poverty have higher rates of violent crimes than people who don't. That's not surprising. In terms of, other measures like drug use, it's even. African-American kids, white kids, they use drugs at approximately the same rates. In fact, I don't remember the name of the study, but one study suggested that, in fact, African-American teenagers are actually less likely to use drugs than white teenagers. But I don't have that.
That's a good question.
Oh, here's
the one
right here.
So we have a lot of prison receivers here, and is there something you could put them towards that would help them, besides their own fine publications, that would kind of point them towards what's not always immediately apparent to them? Until you put up a chart and say, I don't know what this really looks like. Because they're experiencing that in curriculum as well. So what can they do for educating themselves?
About this issue? I would suggest a couple. One is Bruce Western, who's at Harvard, is a wonderful sociologist. I would say he's probably the best known person who studies the effects of mass incarceration on communities of color. So I would start with Bruce Western. And actually, Bruce is cool. He's got this really cool Australian accent, and he also does YouTube videos that are great on this issue. So if you actually look on YouTube for Bruce Western, mass incarceration, you get a great 3-minute clip on this stuff. But he's not the only person. If you're interested in some of the civic effects of mass incarceration, you can look at Beshlo Weaver's work. Beshlo Weaver is at Yale. on the political science department. I would start with the two of them, but there are lots of other places you can go to.
What is the likelihood of people who did graduate high school who are living in more urban areas, what's the likelihood that they will vote?
Their likelihood, I had it earlier, it's also high, but it's not nearly as high. And the other, I want to hazard, don't hold me to this number, but I think it's around 30%. And it's still, that's still an unacceptably high number, right? But here's an important difference, is that because of the way that Americans have organized their society, particularly residentially across the course of the 20th century, intense poverty is concentrated, particularly for African-American communities, in a way where these issues really affect them disproportionately. Now, these are affecting poor white communities too, but poor white communities don't operate in the same way that poor black communities do. It's not as concentrated. It's the easiest way to say it. That's a good question. And actually, the source for some of these, I'm going to try to show this again. I'm just going to zoom through my slides so I can give you the citation on this chart. Here we go. The Prison Policy Initiative. If you go there, they've got some great charts and papers on all this stuff. So I would go there. You can find some really good stuff, including that statistic that you just asked.
First of all, thank you again. I had a related question. You mentioned that the trend is that African-American males who don't graduate high school are actually likely to go to prison. And I was wondering if that's a trend that is growing, if it seems like something that is going to become like alarmingly high in the near future, and also maybe what you've seen research-wise in terms of people suggesting things you can do about it.
Right, that's a great question. There is currently a movement underway. It's a fascinating bipartisan moment where both conservatives and liberals agree that this is really a problem for different reasons, but they agree that it's a problem. And so my understanding is that actual carceral rates in the whole are starting to decline because it's just too expensive to lock all these people up. There's going to be a delay in terms of the effects that this has in certain communities, obviously. I don't know how much that number has changed for African American youth in the last 5 years. I hope that it's peaked and declining, but I don't know that for a fact. And I would actually check out Bruce Western's work on that question as well. In terms of what to do about it, you know, that's one of the big questions in American society and life. What do you do about the legacies of slavery and Jim Crow and the way in which it shaped cities north and south, rural areas north and south? I mean, it's you know, Du Bois said it's the color line. The question of the color line is, you know, the question of the 20th century, and it's, we never solved it, so it's still the question of the 21st century too.
Several weeks ago in Gainesville, there was a symposium held on the topic of racial disparity here in Alachua County. It was staffed by three members of the Andy Casey Foundation, who are well known for child advocacy, et cetera. And one of the staff members asked us in the audience to raise our hands. And the question was whether we thought young African-American men, whether there were more young African-American men aged 18 to 24 in the criminal justice system or in post-secondary education. And 95% of us voted for the criminal justice system. And Everett Mitchell, the guy from the Casey Foundation, pointed out that there are four times as many African-American men aged 18 to 24 in post-secondary education than they are in the criminal justice system. And he argued that this is a counter-narrative that we need to popularize. What do you think about that?
Well, I think it's interesting that he picked that slice of age cohort. So if you extend that age cohort a little bit, you get a different number. And there's also the question of currently, incarcerated versus have ever been incarcerated, which, as we know, has an enormous effect on your life chances in all kinds of ways. Now, I would have to see how we use those stats, and I'm reluctant to expound on that without more knowledge. But what I would also say is that the story of prison is also highly variable. Some prisons are run very well. Some prisons are low security. There's jail. Different states use jail in different ways. And some people actually do go and are able to turn their lives around. But that narrative is not the normal narrative, nor is it really possible for everyone who goes there to turn their lives around, because the services are just not available. And so we have to be careful about also saying, well, it's still in your hands. You can go there and you can turn your life around. Yes, as an individual, maybe, right? But on the aggregate, I'm just talking about aggregates, not like me. And again, not all prisons, not all jails are created equal either. Some are very well run. And again, back to the police, it's important to point out all the ways in which there are many great cops out there who really do keep people safe. And when you are poor, you depend on them very much because you live in places that are more dangerous. And it's also a very difficult job. I think one of the things, back there you were asking about what can we do. One thing we can do about police is not just about training, it's also about how can we make the job a less stressful, safer job. How can we give police more tools so that they can do the kind of work that they go into policing to do? Right? They go in because they want to do a good job, and the job is really hard. Others?
We have time for one more. Curious, your look at the curriculum in many ways seems to focus on the impacts from violent crime and drug crime, similar to what you had. I was wondering what has traditionally been considered white collar crime, and for those types of crime, whether or not there's a separate curriculum for those individuals.
Just for fun, I'd love to pounce on that, but I'm going to be wise and not speak out of what I'm prepared to speak on. It's a great question.
That's it then.
I'm not going to speculate. Oh, you mean that's it for
always in one.
Yeah, it's a great question. Kudos on the question. I'm fully behind the question, but I'm not going to.
First of all, please join me again in thanking Professor Ben Justin. And also for your thoughtful questions about this perennially difficult issue. We've got one more thing to address after what's been a long day already, and that is the opportunity to recognize some of the very best poster presentations from today's symposium. And for that purpose, I want to welcome our Associate Dean for Graduate Studies and Student Services, Nancy Walton.